Before we jump into the video, I'd like to note that technically I did not pick the UEMA 750, rather than impression it, well, with extra steps. This video is meant as a proof of concept, and my technique is far from streamlined, as you will see. The 750 is a very good design, and I hope UEMA doesn't take any offense from this video. In my opinion, all the effort shown in my video just proves how powerful the design is. Hi, this is Captain Hook, and today I will show you a very nice lock, which I got from Decoder, so thank you for this. It's the UEMA 750. It's a free-spinning reverse sidebar core design. So this means this lock has 10 and I think 14 sliders, which have true gate, and there's two springs in here, which are pushing down a metal sheet, and which is part of a sidebar system, which has this metal sheet and another sidebar. And this is pushing down on those sprung sliders, and if they are aligned correctly, it will allow them to enter the core enough to connect the actuator, which is now not movable, with this free spinning core. And when it's spinning, when it's connected like this, then the actuator will turn too. So why can't we pick it? Well, simply because of this reverse sidebar design with this free spinning core, there is no way to apply tension to it. So if you want to tension it, you just spin it and it doesn't care. So there's no picking really. but there is one way to actually decode it, and actually we can make the sidebars tell us how they are positioned correctly simply by watching them very closely with this otoscope, which this one was 24 euros from Amazon. And I basically just look inside and check out when I do this movement where the sidebar is now not aligned with the sliders, so it's pushing on the brass core itself and not pushing on the sliders. But when I turn the core back, it suddenly is pushing on the sliders, and this makes them move just a tiny bit up and down depending on their position. And basically I'm just changing the amount of pressure the sidebar is putting on the sliders, and by this I can see if the sidebar would touch the slider or is touching the slider when it can push on the sliders or it's not. And if it is touching and therefore making the sliders move a tiny bit, I know this cut is not correct. So I can slowly but steadily come up with the correct key. And to make this key, I'm using one of those key blanks. And I basically milled out enough to make a blank. And initially I just milled some from aluminum. So you can see this is the minimum blank you need. And you can even use those vertical lines as indication of where the bitting has to be cut. But the other lines are not so useful, but you can almost do it by eye. But I think if you really want to optimize this technique, you can come up with a better way. Then my way is basically taking this key cutting tool and cutting the bitting in here just like this. So like this you would make a really deep cut, but we don't have to go so aggressive. But this is how I'm cutting my key in the end. And every time I have to insert the key just like one side here and one side on the other side at the same time, then go with the otoscope. Or maybe even use like some tool that when they are in here, or actually I insert this first. This helps with alignment, so you just push it in and it can't flee to the top. And then I have a hole here which allows me with an otoscope to just look down there, but it's as good as if you hold it by hand. It doesn't really matter. The process is not really good. And all in all, I have to say this lock, even though it has this flaw and it can be opened with a very slow technique, it's still pretty safe and you cannot decode it or pick it within a matter of minutes or so. Actually, I didn't even time how long it take me to do it, but the battery on this guy ran out at least. Yeah, it ran out once and it was charged at the beginning and later now, so it really takes some time to do it, at least with my crude setup. But it worked. I was able to retrieve the whole bitting of the easy side, which only has 5 sliders for each side, so in 10 in total. I didn't even try the whole side, the outer side or bigger side, just because it would take so much more time and the principle is the same. Yeah, okay. I'll show you like a run through of my process, and hope you like it, or maybe even can copy the whole process and let me know how it went for you. So have fun with the video. To fully understand what we are doing at the UEMA 750, let's have a look at the two different sidebar types in general. First, we have the standard sidebar, which is being pushed out by springs. So this is a cut through the lock, so the key would come from this side or the other side. So we have this sidebar being pushed this way by a spring. And this slider might be pushed by a spring or not. This is not important here, but the important part is this sidebar will only push onto the slider if we apply some torque, so some rotation, and this sidebar will come out of this groove. Here you can see it's coming out quite a bit. And now it's pushing on this slider. Now we will feel a binding here because there's friction here. So I push here, and when I move this correctly, there will be a click and it starts to turn. So this is how a normal sidebar works. And when we go here, there's a sidebar pushing it out and it will be like this again. Okay, now let's have a look at a reverse sidebar. A reverse sidebar will look like this. You see there is a square groove down here and there's nothing angled like above. So if we now put in our slider and we apply torque, the sidebar will never come in if there's torque. So the only way this sidebar can come up is by a spring pushing on it, so it goes towards the slider, not away like the normal sidebar, but towards the slider. So there is already slight friction between the slider and the sidebar. So this means that this slider should be spring-loaded from the side, so it doesn't shake open, but we have to have a key push it to the right height, at least most of the sliders. There can still be zero cuts. So let's say we are at the wrong position and we apply torque to the whole system. Then we can see the sidebar down here gets stuck from the torque down here, and the springs of the sidebar cannot push it into the slider anymore. So even if it's set correctly, there is no pressure on the slider. So if it's like this and we apply torque, it will not open even if it's set correctly or not. The sidebar will not be able to move because it's pinched down here. So this is the cool part about a reverse sidebar, because we cannot pick this lock like we normally do by applying tension and everything. And we can also not pick it by setting every slider to a certain position, because the sidebar will not hold it there. It will just drop back. So if we don't like use a city rake and move all sliders to some position and it suddenly works and then we apply tension, then we could open the lock by luck, but that's not like single pin picking or single slider picking. That's just luck. That's not like a method we want to use. So, and with the UEMA, it's actually even a step further than this, because even if we wanted to apply tension, the whole thing could rotate. So if you're interested in a crosscut of the UEMA, I would recommend this video here, or I put a link in the description. That's a really great video, and if you're not familiar with the lock, I really recommend you to have a look at this video first. Okay, so the UEMA has another sidebar, which looks like this here. So it's the same idea. We have our reverse sidebar here. This is the sidebar being pushed into the slider. That's very similar to this. But we have a secondary sidebar here, which is actually the one which has the spring load on it. So this spring pushes this secondary sidebar onto the primary sidebar. And if the primary sidebar can enter this here, the secondary sidebar can also enter the core. This is the inside which can rotate then. So in the case here, if the lock is not correct and this sidebar here is not in the gates, this means the secondary sidebar is outside of the core and we can rotate this guy freely without opening the lock. And the secondary sidebar is connected to the actuator of the lock. And if this guy can enter here, then this guy can also enter the core and rotates with this. So this is how the UEMA 750 works. And the cool part is that if we rotate the core like to this position, let's now ignore how the sliders are. Now let's take some fake shorter sidebar. So if we rotate the core like this, then the secondary sidebar cannot put its spring load onto this sidebar. So if we then rotate back and the secondary sidebar can push on it, we can see this guy wiggle a little bit. And this is my approach. And I will show you in reality how it looks in the next part. Okay, so here's how the technique works. Basically, we just start to put some tensioner inside, which is not tensioning but untensioning the lock. Then we have a look into the lock. Let me focus on here. Hope you can see now. And then we start moving our tool, and basically just so that it's like this, you can see. Then we can see who everyone who's moving. So on the left, we can basically see number 5 and 3 come on. So here, 5 and 3 moving. On the other side, it's number 4. And let's check in front. Number 1, you can slightly see he's moving too. So here we already have seen that those 4 are not correct here. And then, for example, when we compare this to the next cut, which I will use some help. So I will use, or let's just use one of those here. And then you can see I've angled the tip and you just stick it in like this. And if I find the other one here, you simply do the same. So, and now let's have it like this. You put this here and there. I think it's already okay like this. Let's focus on here. And you start turning. So now it's already, it doesn't really want to turn, but we can very clearly see that number, what's that, 3 on the left side and number 4 on the right side doesn't do move very clearly. So we also know those are not right. Okay, so we insert this guy with our camera. Camera is facing right like this. We put it in like this. Should be enough. Now we put in the right key like this. So like, okay, and the left key. can see over here, now all we do is turn. So we saw the first one on the right moved. Yeah, that's already something. Maybe we can see another one move. No, that's enough. So let's take out the right one. And I will cut. So I will cut out the corresponding position with my Lishi tool, but I'll do it off camera and be careful because I'm not so used to this guy already. Okay, so here we have our first cut on this key. So put him in. I think if I put him in on this angle and then turn him down, it should work. Should be. Same for this guy. Okay, let's take the otoscope and the tensioner. So there's a very slight move. Oh, you couldn't see. On. Don't know if you can see like this, but you can see. Come on. This white stripe here was moving. Just a little bit. So this one corresponds to number 4 and I'll cut it down on the left. So I've cut this down on the left. Now let's try to insert it again. Now come on. Yeah, I'll use my guide. Okay, so now let's have a check again. Hope you can see like this. Let's insert him. Still moving. Okay, this one flipped out, but I think you can also see it, that this one wasn't cut down enough. So I will just add another cut. So I've rearranged a bit so you can see better what the otoscope sees. This is still what we have on our cut down keys. I'll use those raw keys as a guide for inserting. Okay. And now on the other side too. Just need to shift it over. Okay. Let's check with the otoscope. Looks good. And tension. Move. We see number 3 on the right is clearly moving to both sides. So let's cut him down. The key now looks like this. I'll use those here as a guide again. So like this, I'll insert him. Let's check if it's right. Looks good. Let us use this here. And we still see, come on, I hope you can see it on the video, but number 3 is still moving down, so we cut him deeper. So I'll speed it up a little bit. I'll show you on the end how the bitting was. So now we can see, I think it's number 4. Oops. It's number 4 on the left side that moved. Come on, I saw you move. Now you could see it. It's number 4 on the left. So let's give him a cut. And here you can see how the bitting was. And this. Okay. So, whoops. This is now the second one on the right moving. Okay, it just jumped out. Still looks like this. And this. So the first one on the left moves slightly. And the second one, too. Also the course now not turning freely, it's only within some limits, so the sidebar is already in a little bit. Okay, and again. So there's not much movement at all now. So the sidebar doesn't allow enough rotation. So I think we are pretty close to the actual bitting now, which by the way looks like this on the right and like this on the left. So let's see if we can find out more information in a different way. Okay, long story short. This is how close I got the bitting of my impressioning technique to the actual key. On these sides, you can see the left and the right bitting, which I just copied from here, so you can compare the bitting more easily. So we can see, for example, this cut here is not quite accurate, and here this one is also missing out. Here is maybe one, but I think within the tolerances of the lock, this one here wouldn't matter. And probably, yeah, it's if you roughly wiggle it at the end, you can probably cope with these minimum cuts, which are close from here. Like this one here is the maximum lift, and this here is so close to it that it's probably if you wiggle a bit, but doesn't matter. So basically only these two cuts here are missing, and let's find out if there's a last way of getting this information from the lock. Okay, so now I've put the keys with the almost correct bitting in, and it's now blocking the rotation so much that I do not get any feedback. So if I do this, I can't turn more than this. And there's also no one moving. Oh, actually, I'm wrong. You can see the second on the right is moving. Okay, but the second one on the left, which we already compared, is not moving. So we will do the following trick. We will now use a hook, look inside, and push on each slider. So if we check this one, we can see the one on the right doesn't move and the others also not. If we check on this one is not right and it pushes the sidebar down, which is immediately making the second one to shake also. So we know these two are not correctly. In this way, we can both give them the last cuts, and then we should have our working keys. Okay, this one came out. So I'll show you that these are the not perfectly correct keys. So now it's time to take the last two cuts. And because this is like the most critical cut, I will also demonstrate it. So we just put it on our key cutter like this, to the right height. And when we think it's okay, I will push down on those two sides because otherwise it could bend too much. And we got ourselves a cut here. And the same on this one. Okay, should be close enough. Let's no. Okay, like this. And done. It's a little bit bent, but this we can just fix by hand. Okay, now let's try them out. Okay, now for the last time, I've inserted both keys, which should now be at the correct height. I can double check that this is the case. So we can see the keys are in there. So now I'll take my tensioner and put it right here. And now I can turn the whole lock, and you can also see the actuator here in the back being turned. So like this, the lock is picked or decoded, and we have our own made up key here. So here we have our lock, which has the made up keys or the copied key inside. Here's the bitting, and now we will take this apart. Ready two springs. And two caps that prevent the springs from being eaten. Then we have some core retainer clip here in the back. Now I will just insert the key. So no sliders can come out. It's just a tailpiece. Now we have one sidebar here, which is normally inside. So here's this sidebar, which is normally inside this groove here, and is connected to the actuator by this here. So only then the actuator can turn. If this is in here and down in this, this core here can turn freely, but the sidebar here is stopping the actuator from turning only when it's fallen inside. Then both can turn at the same time. So this is the idea behind the lock. And now we'll just have a brief look on this. There's a ball bearing which is at the tip, and this actual sidebar which is testing the gates, which we can see in here. So here are the sliders on the side, and this is actually the decoding. So this is a 1, a 2, and this is a 3 cut. Here again are the aligned gates and even more sliders. So I don't really want to take it apart much more. But yeah, that's all you need to know.